I definitely was not confident in the beginning in any way. I had been advised by a media trainer person to not come out, like, before.
So wow. Let's talk about that. I want to talk about that.
Welcome to Queer the Music, the podcast from Mercury Studios that uncovers the LGBTQ+ anthems that have dominated dance floors and shaped queer lives. I'm Jake Shears. In this episode, we're talking about a hit from 2015 that went straight to the top of the UK charts and was named Song of the Year by Time Magazine. It's the compulsively danceable King by electropop then trio Years and Years. My guest for this episode is Olly Alexander. Since Years and Years debut, Olly's been a champion of LGBTQ+ rights, issues, proudly celebrating his queerness by writing inclusive songs, displaying queer love in his music videos. To me, Olly represents a true example of queer pop stardom. And because he's the generation after mine, I was curious to hear about his experience and to see how much has changed since I hit the mainstream and how much might just be part and parcel of being a queer pop star. Olly, welcome to Queer the Music. How are you doing?
Hi, I'm so good. Thank you. Thank you for having me.
I'm just so excited that you're here with me. Yeah.
Me too. That was such a nice intro. But did Time really call it the Song of the Year? I had no idea that was a thing.
I think so, yeah.
That's amazing. Yeah. Oh my God.
You find out this stuff years later.
I had no idea about that.
But I want to talk about King. Can you take me back to when you were writing these songs for the first record? I know there was probably a lot of stuff before you signed to Polydor.
Yeah.
Do you remember what year King was written?
So we started around 2010, and we started making music really casually. The way King ended up was so different to how it began. It began as like a song that I was writing like piano. Around 2014, I was dating a guy. Well, actually dating a string of guys that were just like really bad, messy relationships, like typical early 20s, falling in and out of love. And I had this song about like a guy, and in the song I'd referenced him being like a king. And then it went through so many different transformations, actually, the song. And then in the end, it was like, I was a king under your control. It kind of got flipped.
Just taking back to that moment.
Oh yeah,
like, just as far as like, you're in your early 20s.
Yes.
You're in London.
Yes, that's right.
Now, when you say that you were writing casually at first, what does that mean? Like, where were you guys? Literally, like, what rooms were you in?
I was living in a house with Mikey at the time, who was playing bass in Battersea. And sometimes we'd rehearse at our house in Battersea. And then sometimes we'd get into, like, a rehearsal room, like, nearby. Or there was one in Hackney. There's a venue called Premises that we used to go to. Still there.
I'm still there.
And I guess in the beginning, you write songs and you have no real like idea of where it's going to go. It's just, I mean, for me anyway, I was just writing songs because I like to do it. And then start to perform them at gigs. And that was so exciting. And we were all kind of just making songs as we'd go along, really. I would write the song at a piano and then bring it to the rehearsal room. And we'd figure out a way to play it live. That was kind of it. And then as things progressed a bit and we got signed, it's like, okay, well, you're going to release this song now. So it has to be right. Label kind of come in and go, do you want to release this? Or what we think it's to sound a little bit more like this song. That was a whole entire new process for us and for me, but one that worked very well for King, because going back to that song and kind of reworking it really helped, I think.
How many songs did y'all have under your belt when you got signed by Polydor?
Well, I thought that we had our album pretty much like wrapped up. We had a lot of songs, they weren't finished, but then we got signed and then I remember someone saying this to me at the time. They were like, the work begins now. Because you get signed, you think, oh my gosh, I won the lottery. You know what I mean? That's like such a big kind of place. I don't know if you were like this, but you get signed, you're like, oh my God, this is it. But then the hard work kind of like really did begin again in a way. Because we kind of went back to the drawing board with the album, wrote loads more new songs. But King definitely was from before we got signed.
Yeah.
And kind of got reworked.
And so when y'all were producing the tracks, like say once Polydor signed, y'all, were you using Logic? Were you using Pro Tools?
Like, I want to know
what rooms you were in and who was at the decks?
Like, oh, yeah. Okay. So it went through like so many different versions, but basically when it really came together, we actually did in a few different places, strong rooms in Old Street, just off Old Street. I don't know if you've been there. It's a funny studio, got amazing decoration inside. with a guy called Andy Luxury, who is a producer and artist.
Sounds like a producer.
I know, Luxury.
What a great name.
And so literally we would still be kind of just figuring out the song, still creating stuff. And Andy came up with the because we wanted like a hook that would kind of come in between the verse and the bridge after the chorus. So we did a bit of work on the song there. And then we took it to Mark Ralph's studio, which is at the time was in Queen's Park. The desk is actually one of two desks made for Kraftwerk, like Kraftwerk made them.
Yes. Isn't it amazing though, you know, going into studios and making records and when you're really like finally, you know, cutting a record with these desks, there's always so many stories behind them.
I know.
It's awesome.
And it's like so intimidating when you first go into a studio. Like to me, when you imagine a studio, like that's what you see, the desk, like the huge mixing desk. It's got like hundreds of channels, all these knobs, and you're like, what do they do? It's very like overwhelming and confusing. And also it's a part of the process that's kind of taken out a lot nowadays.
Yes.
For people kind of making music in studios and stuff. And it's, but producers will tell you, you can't replicate what it sounds like going to the desk. And I at first didn't believe them, but now I do. I think they're right.
Can't agree. It's true. I love being in studios for that reason, just because of the history. And then you're adding to that history when you know, someday you never know, someone might be saying that your record was put through this desk.
You're so right. That's such a magical part of studios. And whenever I go to a new studio, I'm like, oh, who else has recorded here? Just like, yeah. So I'm kind of breathing the same air as whoever was here, you know?
When you were going into these studios, you'd been signed. You had these songs. What was going on in your mind? Were you excited? Were you scared?
Yes, both of those things. I had wanted to be a songwriter for as long as I can remember. So having the opportunity to be like, okay, people, these are my songs, you know, people are going to hear. I mean, that's still the coolest thing ever to me. But you only ever get to experience that when it's kind of all happening the first time, you know, your first time your song's on the radio and first time you get signed and you sign your deal and you know, first time you're making money. And it was all so overwhelming and terrifying because I really, 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 really wanted to be like amazing, like never make a mistake ever, be completely perfect and wow everybody, which is like really quite hard to achieve. Well, I've definitely put a lot of pressure on myself.
A perfectionism would sort of set in.
Yeah, or just never good enough. It's like, okay, well, it should have been better. I really had that mindset for a long time. I know it's only like 8 years ago, but 7 years ago, 8 years ago. But I feel like I've moved on from that now.
Yeah. I mean, that sort of perfectionism, I find it's easy to let it creep in.
Yeah.
You do have to sort of let it go at a certain point.
I think so, because I don't know if you find this, but we're in such like an inflated, everything's about you being amazing, you're a star, you wow, you know, you changed my life, inspirational. These are amazing things, but like quite hard to embody as a person. Like you can't really walk around your life being that. You have to just, otherwise you're just constant disappointment to yourself and to everyone around you. Which is like, I don't want to feel that way, you know?
No.
Back to King.
Back to King. Going back lyrically to what the song's about. So you were dating and it was an asshole boyfriend. Really?
Oh, yeah.
Was this about one person specifically?
It's about a couple of different people, but really the actual song's relationship was about one person who I was really like caught up about at the time. And I felt like I was just kind of finding myself in these relationships with like dudes that I felt like just kind of didn't treat me very well, or like I was just going in for like the wrong guy and getting my heart broken and getting trampled on a bit and just feeling like, oh, why does this keep happening, you know? But kind of being drawn to those relationships, yeah, you know, drawn to that dynamic and that kind of attraction to the toxicity in a way.
There's something that can like sometimes feel good about that pain.
Exactly. So that song was really about that contradicting feeling.
Yeah.
But also about wanting to literally let it go, you know.
And how were you feeling at the time being gay and out and, you know, you've just signed to a major? What was going through your mind in that regard?
Yeah.
So how did you feel about that?
I think it's taken me a long time to actually feel confident as a musician and a songwriter and to be in a studio, which is tends to be like a male-dominated environment with a bunch of dudes that might not necessarily be completely on board with what I'm trying to say. Not because they're like homophobic or something, but because it's just a different experience, or that they're not used to having a gay person wanting to write the song. Okay. And it doesn't matter if you're gay or not. It can be hard to like assert yourself in those environments. So that's taken me a while. But even just as like being confident with my sexuality, I definitely was not confident in the beginning in any way. And I felt really scared. And I had been advised by a media trainer person to not come out like before.
So wow. Let's talk about that.
It was... So it was someone who had been kind of drafted in from, I guess, a company that kind of do this sort of thing where they speak to people going into the public eye about media training.
Yeah.
So I was interested to meet with her and see what she had to say. And she goes, oh, you know, how do you feel about your sexuality? Talking about your sexuality. And obviously I didn't really know what I was going to do, but I thought, well, probably better to be open, honest about it. Because I just feel like having to keep this a lie is that's... That doesn't sound like fun. Sounds exhausting. It doesn't seem to work very well. And her response was, well, why should you have to come out? You know, like, why does anyone need to know about that? And you might want to think about protecting yourself and in the future and stuff. Ooh. It does sound bad.
Oh, but like these PR people, like, it's just like people can like creep into your ear in a way and make you question yourself, make you doubt yourself, make you think like, oh, maybe I should.
I know.
Maybe not talk about this.
I know.
It's so insidious.
It is. It is. And it's difficult because I can see where she was coming from. It is a different time, but it's absolutely the wrong advice, by the way. But it made me go, all right, well, that's not what I'm going to do. It kind of made me think, no, I actually have to be honest about this. Even in 2014, slightly, the digital media landscape was so different. I feel like nowadays... It's very much about people's expression on their social media. But still in 2014, the paper, they were outing Sam Smith. That was going to happen until Sam kind of got there first. And that was very much still happening. And I had to sort of wait until I was asked in an interview to come out, which I thought was weird. I'm already out to everyone. Yeah. You're waiting until an interviewer asks you the question, then you can say yes, and then it's in print, you know?
So yeah.
Just weird. I don't know. It's just a strange... Then it happened and it was just a relief. It was like, oh, thank God, I don't have to like... You know, it was so early on and didn't make any noise because we were still such a kind of small band.
Yes.
I think I did some press to do with South by Southwest and I just mentioned my boyfriend and that was it, really. So I think I managed to like kind of just slip in there unnoticed.
Yeah.
So by the time people had any awareness of me, they were like, oh, it's that gay singer. Which was a relief by that point.
Well, it was exciting to me. I was in Los Angeles when the first Year's album came out and it was a moment for me. You know, first Scissors album was 2004, so it was like 11 years later, and it was just so great to see a out young male pop star happening. It just made me really happy to see that.
That's so nice. I love that.
How,
thanks, Jake.
So
you know, but like that's amazing for me to hear because you inspired me. Do you know what I mean? Like that's actually very cool, you know. I couldn't have been doing it if you hadn't done it, you know what I mean?
And I couldn't have been doing it if those who came before, you know, if Holly Johnson hadn't have been out there with Frankie or whatnot. So how, once you felt that sort of relief of being, you're like, okay, so it's out that I'm gay, everything's going really well, how deliberate did you feel about putting those themes into your songs? What did it feel like to carry that once you sort of felt like it was out? You said it was a relief at first, and then what?
It's scary because, you know, there were like my extended family members. I hadn't sat them down and told them I was gay, you know. It was kind of all happening at once. It felt like King was going, with the song came out, the album came out, people were talking about me, I'm gay, everyone knows.
Yeah.
And I was really scared about what was going to happen, but what happened was... by like overwhelmingly large amount, like people were so supportive and the fans of the music were so supportive and coming to the show and waving rainbow flags and talking to me and sending me messages about their own experience with their sexuality. My eyes were opened about how many people wanted to support a gay artist, how many people wanted to come to the show and be a part of what we were doing. And so that was cool. I was like, oh, well, me being myself, that actually is a good thing.
Yeah.
Sounds so stupid, but it was, you know, and it is. It connects with people.
Also, the music the music transcended
exactly.
All of that, you know what I mean? And that's what I loved seeing from afar, you know, was the quality of what y'all were doing was so good that it wasn't necessarily all about that.
Oh, yeah, exactly. That's the thing. And I hope, we're always there to just mainly give the audience a good time, have fun. And of course, I'm gay and that's there and it's present. But it was just really one of the best things is about how it didn't matter to a lot of people. They're just enjoying the music and enjoying the vibe. And that's obviously the great thing about music. It just brings us together and it's so like instinctual and, unites us. And I'm so happy to have been a part of that experience coming out with Years and Years and the success we had and seeing that with my own eyes was very cool.
When it all starts popping off, right? When like you can't go to the bathroom without like somebody like banging at the door and screaming, right. You know what I mean? You know, right. Those moments when it's exciting and you're exhausted, mm-hmm. You're getting recognized everywhere. Like, how did that affect you? How did you get over that? Like, how did you?
I was definitely like so in a sort of state of bewilderment, I think, most of the time, mm-hmm. kind of bit deer in the headlights. Because you're right, can't really believe it's happening and it's so exciting, but it's just deeply, I would get very stressed. Like if someone recognizes me, my heart rate like instantly rises mm-hmm. and I start sweating and I'm like, mm-hmm. oh God, this is like embarrassing. I'm the embarrassed, nervous person in the interaction. And then, just be like, oh God, I'd get like major anxiety about that happening. Just because I felt like I was, I don't know. And there's that bit of a weird crossover where you'll still take the tube. But at the time, like I'm still doing everything like I normally have and like people recognizing me. And I'm just feeling like so inadequate. And, like I'm just eating a sandwich on the tube and I'm embarrassed that you've met me. And now I'm going to look terrible in that picture that you're probably going to put online. And
yeah,
I don't know. It's just weird. It starts to enter your brain in a way and you start thinking about it. And you're like, I've never thought about these things before. And now I've sort of got this thing going on my head where I'm like, oh, does that person recognize me? What are they doing? And what do I look like? What am I doing? And
it adds a whole other layer into your life. I went into a deep, deep depression.
Yeah.
It took me a long time to figure out how to get out of it. Like,
I mean, it's a lot. And like, it's like good to hear you say that. Cause like, you're really trying to be like, oh, this is amazing. It's the best thing that's ever happened to me. But you're also at the same time, why does this make me feel so depressed and like not want to leave the house?
Yeah. There's something warping about going through something like that. You do have to like do work to sort of like iron yourself out again in a way.
It's so unnatural. I don't think a human being should really be in that environment in a way. You know, for a human to be like so kind of in the spotlight and then elevated and kind of...
It's not a natural thing.
No, I don't think it's super healthy.
I think that there's a way that you just have to like learn how to like...
Yeah.
Deal with it. Like I went into a deep depression myself. Exactly what you're talking about. Like, you know, feelings of inadequacy, thinking that you're not supposed to be there. And I think being put on this sort of gay pedestal as well is also a part of it. And feeling like you're representing a whole community. And you're just like, but it's just me. I can't necessarily represent all these people. Or I didn't necessarily feel worthy some of the time of people looking up to me like that.
Oh, completely, completely. And I really relate to that. Once I kind of understood that a bit, that I couldn't represent anybody apart from myself, and even then I'm not doing a great job of it probably some of the time. Once I kind of understood that, I felt, and I still really, really try, but I was like so kind of hard on myself that like, I'm the wrong person for this topic. I shouldn't be talking about being gay. I'm like taking up too much space. I'm the only gay person on this lineup. I'm the only gay person in this interview. I should be saying this. I should be doing this. Do you know what I mean? I had to let that go because you're always going to fail and you can't do that.
It's not going to get you anywhere. Did you go into therapy?
Oh yeah. I was going to say like I started seeing my therapist in 2013, 2014 and I still speak to him. Gosh, that's nearly 10 years. Wow.
Like record labels should literally have like a therapist, psychiatrist put into the contract itself. Yes. What do you think of now when you look back at yourself 10 years ago with the 10 year distance? What do you see?
I think, oh, my skin was so much better. No, all jokes aside, what do I think? So I see someone kind of uncomfortable in their skin a bit. Mm-hmm. I don't know if other people see this, but like I have a bit of a hard time watching that stuff because I wish I could just tell myself to relax. Like I can see the tension in my shoulders and my chin or the way I'm singing or the way I'm standing. And I feel like I emanate this just like wanting to please so mm-hmm. much, wanting mm-hmm. to just like make you laugh, make you smile, make you clap or something.
Yeah.
It's just like coming off of me and I just yeah. see it and I'm like, oh, it makes me feel a bit uncomfortable.
Yeah. I feel that. I feel that when I there's,
do you?
There's yeah, when there's like you go on a TV show or something. But it's yeah, always gonna be like that.
I know.
You know what I mean? It's yeah. always gonna be looking back.
But also I think I look cute too. Just wanted to throw that in there because it's so hard to like look at yourself and go like, oh, I don't look terrible. Now I feel like I have enough distance where I'm like, oh, I looked cute.
Adorable.
Oh,
absolutely
thanks.
Adorable. Are you kidding? So sweet.
Oh, thanks.
Very sweet.
I'm blushing.
What kind of role models did you have growing up as far as like musical role models? Were any of them queer?
My first kind of like musical loves were like the Spice Girls and Britney Spears.
Yeah.
1997. Huge year for music.
Yeah.
And I really fell in love with those artists, you know. And then I think that's quite common as well for lots of people, but for young gay boys. And then I reached an age where I realized it wasn't acceptable to like those kinds of artists. And so I kind of pretended I mean, I didn't dislike Nirvana, but I just pretended I was like more into Nirvana and that sort of thing for a while. And then I came back around to pop music and also singer-songwriters, like I was obsessed with Jeff Buckley. And Jeff Buckley wasn't gay, but to me he was.
There's an openness there.
There is an openness. Yes. There's an openness. And I felt really like I didn't identify with any male singers, apart from Stevie Wonder, who I just thought had the most incredible voice. I still think this. And I was obsessed with. But most male singers I didn't really identify with. My mum loved George Michael. But at first I didn't really get George Michael. I didn't have a way into it until I got a bit older. But Jeff Buckley, yeah, I really, really fell in love with, and I put on my whole queer storyline onto him.
I think that's a great queer music role model.
Yeah.
I do. I think that's a really interesting answer.
Yeah.
I think there's something to that.
It was also because I was like in love with my best friend at school who was straight, and he loved Jeff Buckley, and I felt like...
That's romantic.
I know. And I felt like Jeff was probably the kind of guy who like... I don't know, had like a man that loved him and he was friendly with, I don't know. I was really reading into it.
That's dreamy. It's a dream that's making my heart melt. Yeah. Just thinking about it. If you had to choose a song, like just one song that had just like a major impact
so hard
on that's you, right. I know it's tough.
I feel like I've thought about this and I have to choose, even though it's maybe a bit obvious, It's a Sin by the Pet Shop Boys.
Yeah.
I've always thought that song was like one of the most incredible expressions of like the gay experience. It's so Neil Tennant, it's so Pet Shop Boys, it's so of its time, but it's, I don't know, it's describing this like holy, euphoric, painful, tortured, blissful, fucked up experience of being gay and alive. And I love that song. And then it became obviously the title for the TV show It's a Sin, and it took on a whole other meaning in my life. And then I performed it with the Pet Shop Boys and with Elton John. And I mean, that song has really come to represent so much.
Yeah.
And me. I'm there too, which is the coolest thing ever.
You're part of the history of that song.
It's the coolest thing ever, you know.
And isn't it strange how there's so much... I love the full circle of life and just like growing up, being a music fan, having that be a part of your life. And then... all the full circle moments that come around, you know, it's magical.
It's really,
and it will
cool.
continue. And so
it's continue.
The landscape, we're looking at, you know, King 2015. We're in 2023, of course, now.
Yes.
All this changed. All the artists that have, you know, been coming out that are seeing success, you know, got Lil Nas X, Christine and the Queens, Sam Smith, Kim Petras, like, you know, it just keeps growing, it seems like. I get asked the question all the time, like, how has it changed since you started?
Mm.
And how do you feel about getting asked that question? I'm more interested in how you feel about that question than the answer to that question itself, because there's something about it that annoys me a little bit. How do you feel about that? And yeah, what do you think of that question?
I know what you're saying, because everything exists in its own context, right? And everything changes at different speeds, and... sometimes I feel like I have a whiplash over how fast things change. And then sometimes I think nothing's changed, really. I have this suspicion that human beings, we've kind of been quite similar for thousands of years, but the society just kind of legislates different ways to control different people, put them in different groups. I feel like we as a society maybe like really want to hold on to this idea that progress moves in a line and we get better as a society, more equal. And that's definitely true in some ways. But in others, I'm kind of like, we're still where we were. Like lots of these attitudes, you know, like I see people come for Sam Smith and Kim and it's because they're trans. It's because they look the way they look. And I know that that is coming for me. Like that includes me down the line, you know what I mean? Like if we're not able to like just, we're only able to have certain acceptable types of queer behavior, certain types of acceptable queer pop stars or whoever it is, not all about pop stars, but then it's fine. But as soon as it kind of transgresses in a way that's too far this way, too far that, then it all falls apart. I'm like, well, we're still not where we should be. Like, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's, yeah.
And what do you think the biggest challenge is right now for LGBTQ artists?
I feel like we're in the midst of a huge, well, a pretty big LGBT backlash. And I feel like we could, probably a lot of reasons why that's happening. I don't know. Maybe we've had like a good run of the last few years where it was kind of prevailing liberal democracies and liberal values. And that's kind of swung back now. And I feel like we're seeing a bit of a backlash from right-wing governments, our own government, from various different places. And so we're all having to live in this time. And I think any artist is going to have to deal with that. Like we were kind of saying earlier, sexuality is just like one tiny part of the story, you know. And we all have multiple identities. And, you know, depending on how those intersect, like that's going to really impact your journey as an artist. That's before you get, you know, what's the team you're working with and what are they like?
Yeah.
What's the label? The label going to understand what your vision? Probably not. Maybe. You might get lucky. I think we've reached a point where because of social media and because of the power of like artists going direct to their audience, artists like Lil Nas X, like Kim Petras, like so undeniable how popular they are. You know, a label can't ignore that. A label can't get in the way of that.
Let's go back just and talk about what is, you know, this last album was fantastic. Night Call was so amazing. And the touring's so good. The shows were amazing.
Oh, thank you.
I love the record.
Thank you.
It's so fun. What are you looking at now? What's next?
I'm making the new one, actually, which has been fun. I'm hoping this one will be... Usually it takes me like 4 years to make an album, which is kind of long.
I'm right there with you, though.
Yeah. It's weird that it shouldn't take that long, but it does. But this time I feel like I'm doing it a bit quicker. And Night Call was really fun. That whole album and time was about trying to just find the fun somewhere. And I'm still carrying that on a bit, but... just trying to, I don't know, like just creating stuff that feels really like free and not really having too much of an idea of where I'm going, really.
Yeah.
And just trying to like fall back in love with the process of it. Because I do love it, but you can really easily lose that, I think.
Well, it's also the best part.
Exactly. It really is. When it's all kind of in the creation stage and you're imagining what it's going to be and what it'll look like and how it's going to feel and... That's exciting.
It's the most fun.
Yeah.
It's the most fun bit. It's fun. It all depends on who you're with and who you're working with.
It really does.
And what's going on in the room.
When we came back with the second album, I was kind of like, oh, I want to be a bit sexier now. Things seem to fall apart, really, when that happened with the label, you know. And I may be reading too much into it, but I feel like you had some of a similar...
Totally. very
much
so. I
mean, you said it, so yeah.
Yeah.
And I remember thinking about you at that time and being like, like, how is this still, like, happening? I don't know.
No, it's just, like, bringing that sort of sexuality out into the forefront.
People get and very then
it's just,
scared.
And yeah.
Yeah.
The door just gets slammed in your face.
Yeah.
And you bring out sort of overt gay sexuality or overt queer sexuality. And, you know, yeah, the curtain just...
Yeah, it's too much.
Draws down.
People get a bit like...
Yeah. I mean, you just lose support.
Yeah.
Right. The labels in so many ways, at least, you know, when I was still in a major just in the States and over here, it's all mostly straight men.
Mm-hmm. And they're marketing companies, really. Like,
yeah.
And they want to market the most units to
the
most people.
And they get scared of it. They just look at it and they're like, what are we going to do with this? What are we going to do with, you know, a man's ass on the cover of this?
But one of the most iconic covers ever.
That's what I was saying.
One of the most iconic covers ever. It really is.
That's why I said to David Joseph, he was like, we were in a, we were, we, oh, we, he, I had Elton on the phone being like, you can't do this. I had David Joseph on the phone, and I said to him, Clive Davis called up Patti Smith and got the cover for this Patti Smith record, shot by Robert Mapplethorpe, and was, you know, this woman on the cover of the record, like in men's clothes and a mustache, you know, I'm not having that. And it turned out to be Patti Smith Horses. And I was like, and that's Patti Smith Horses by Robert Mapplethorpe. And I was like, this is Sister Sister's Night Work.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. You know, I look back now and I was like, I was really shooting myself in the foot.
Do you think, like, what if I hadn't done that?
I wouldn't take it back. No, exactly. I wouldn't take it back, but it I was in denial in the moment. I really didn't think I was. I really thought that I sort of, like, knew it all. But yeah, sometimes you just have to take those chances.
I think so. Yeah. You just got to do it anyway, right?
You got to do it anyway. So when you got out and were playing shows to larger audiences and seeing and playing King for the first time, what were you seeing out in the audience?
Girls. Like young girls.
Interesting.
And that was a shock, really, because you just don't know who's going to come to your show. But if you have young girls coming to your show, that's a good sign.
Yes, it
They're
is.
Like the number one category you want.
Yeah.
And actually kind of a mixture. It was definitely like a real younger fan base and mixed with older people. We were still playing really small shows. And it sounds crazy to say, but back then a song would be on the radio and you couldn't buy it.
So bonkers.
That's how they used to do it. They used to get people to pre-order the song, right? So they'd hear it on the radio and go, oh, I like that song. And you pre-order it because you couldn't, you know. And still, it was slightly before streaming, just slightly. So you couldn't stream it. So sounds completely wild to think about now. But the song was on the radio and then a month later came out, went to number one. So by the time we kind of played it, people already knew the words. You know, like people were singing along. It was just insane. I was like, how is this happening? You know, it's amazing. And it's still so amazing to play. It's the best song to play live. We play it last and everyone just sings along. It's so fun.
Well, yeah, it still warms your heart.
Yeah, I went through a phase of hating it. Hating to sing it because, well, it's a hard song to sing, actually. It's right at the top of my range. But then I was like, let's bring it down a key.
Yeah,
to make it slightly easier. and just enjoy it. Because then I realized as well, you can get the audience to sing it. The bits that are too hard.
Yes.
Just go, and so I love it now again, yeah.
Good. I feel like with I Don't Feel Like Dancing, there came a point where I'd sung it so many times that I couldn't get through the song without forgetting the lyrics.
Oh, that's so interesting. I do that too. I forget lyrics of the songs I sing the most.
Isn't it weird? It's like a weird trap in your brain. And
yeah,
like,
I always forget the lyrics to King.
This is more of an observation, I guess, that we were talking about earlier. And you do something that I really can't do. There's a vulnerability in your lyrics and going back through the years and years stuff, there's a deep romance to the music, this yearning, this like beautiful aching feel to the lyrics that like I cannot do. I can't write like that at all. And if I do, I have to couch it in characters. If I try to write songs like that, it just does not come out. It's embarrassing for me, but where do you think that comes from? Where do you think that vulnerability comes from?
Well, when I first started to write song, I kept a diary. I still keep a diary, but the songs, and you know, I'd write like poems and stuff, and that's kind of the approach I take to a song. It's like it's a little poem, and my favorite thing about poems and songs and, well, anything really, is the kind of like contradictory nature of everything. And I would always be writing my diary like, oh, I feel sad. And that's where a lot of the lyrics would kind of start from. And that's why I wanted to be a songwriter in a way. It was about like just getting some of that onto a page and then expressing it. And so I guess I just carried that on. I don't know. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Kind of as a style. Because I suppose we all have different styles, don't we? And I always love a song that's, you know, where the pain is like mixed in. And it's funny because I've been in certain songwriting sessions, I've worked with other writers, and sometimes that can be going to kind of go against the songwriting. You know, if you're songwriting 101, you're trying to be like really clear, get all the kind of your metaphors lined up and your senses, what it sounds like, smells like, tastes like, what's the story for the song, blah, blah, blah. And I don't always like to do that. I like to kind of be like, no, by the chorus, we feel different. You know, I don't know.
I like writing a bunch of nonsense sometimes.
That too, like that's
absolutely freeing. Doesn't make any sense.
Is that how you came up with like some of the Scissor Sisters?
Definitely, Scissor Sisters stuff, yeah.
I always wondered though, like how did they come up with that? Like,
yeah, no, just being silly, just seeing like how like ridiculous,
yeah,
you know, something can be. I started writing songs to like shock and like,
yeah,
and to be funny.
I think being funny is one of the most important things you should try and you should prioritize that. You know, no, yeah. People don't prioritize it enough, like, in a way, like, having fun is what I mean, like, being fun. And then the funny thing is, like, a lyric like I Don't Feel Like Dancing, like, that can take on so many meanings, you know? Mm. And, like, it can be very profound, as well as being, like, kind of throwaway.
Which yeah.
Is, that's the sweet spot.
Oh.
Yeah.
You're the sweet spot.
Woo!
That's all for this time. I want to give a huge thanks to Olly Alexander. I'm going to be back next week.
I wrote 1950 at 17, and it blew up completely randomly with no marketing, no nothing.
How did you handle that success?
Not well.
But if you can't wait that long, then why not delve into our archive, where you can catch up on incredible stories, including Peaches on Fuck the Pain Away and Rebecca Lucy Taylor, AKA Self-Esteem, on I Do This All the Time. But now, let's get back to the music, crank up the volume, raise your hands, and enjoy King in Full.